And welcome. My name is Luc Litar, and I'm ODIHR's project coordinator. It's my pleasure today to be your moderator for the last and shortest working session of this Human Dimension Implementation Meeting. At ODIHR, we have come to use the shorthand title project session for this last working session, but the full title is Discussion of Human Dimension Activities with a special emphasis on project work. This session has always provided us with an opportunity to present a wide range of project activities undertaken across the OSCE region. And in recent years, we have tried to give particular attention to activities implemented by OSCE field operations and institutions other than ODIHR. Today, the focus will be a bit more on ODIHR's work, which we think is justified given the 25th anniversary of our office. But you will hear the speakers talk a lot about cooperation and coordination, about synergies, and about multi-layered approaches. And you will hear about the past, the present, and the future. And all this, of course, before then we open the floor for your comments and recommendations. So I hope this will be a short but pleasant final stage, and if I may, if you allow me a little metaphor using the Tour de France, I hope a rather scenic ride to the Champs-Élysées than a grueling last mountain stage. The speakers list is still open. We have for the time being only four speakers, so please, if you want to sign up, it's still possible at the head table behind me. I would just like to remind you that speakers can only take the floor in the capacity in which they are registered, and only entities registered on the speakers list can be represented. We'd also kindly ask participants to submit their statements before the session or before speaking to the interpreters. Thank you very much. We hope to end the session the latest at 11:15, as we need to make some preparations for the closing session, which should start punctually at 11:30. Okay, so now it's my pleasure to introduce our first introducer, and that nobody less than the ODIHR's first deputy director, Ms. Katarzyna Juroszewicz-Wargan. I'm sure she's by now a very familiar face at this table, so I can keep the introduction short. As a first deputy director of ODIHR, Katarzyna Juroszewicz-Wargan is responsible for managing the operations of the ODIHR, overseeing the preparation, coordination and implementation of the activities of the election, democratization, human rights, tolerance and non-discrimination programs, and of the contact point for Roma and Sinti issues, as well as for formulation of the ODIHR public message. So with this, I would like to give the floor to Katarzyna Juroszewicz-Wargan. The floor is yours.
Thank you very much, Luke. And before I start with a very short presentation of the 25 years of our project work, let me just thank all of you for being with us here at this certainly very interesting and intensive 2 weeks of the 20th Human Dimension Implementation Meeting. The project work is one of the tools in the OSCE toolkit, and a very important one, as demonstrated by the numerous staff implementing project activities on a daily basis across all structures of our organization. As underlined in this working session in previous years, projects fulfill multiple roles in our organization, building capacity, raising awareness, creating tools and mechanisms, and they also build confidence, help prevent conflicts, and strengthen our ongoing engagement with our counterparts, contributing to broader goals. As appropriate in an anniversary year and at the end of another two fascinating weeks of the Human Dimension Implementation Meeting, I would like to briefly look back at some of the main achievements of our office over the past 25 years, many of which would not have been possible without generous extra-budgetary support from our OSCE participating states. Far from trying to be exhaustive, I would like to mention some activities which illustrate the approach ODIHR has followed, and you will see also some of the photographs that illustrate that approach as well. The key principles of that approach are multi-year and program-oriented engagement, responsiveness to requests, working at the same time with state authorities and civil society, ensuring strong local ownership, creating platforms for discussion and cooperation, and transferring good practices within the OSCE region. To achieve its goals, our office performs three core functions: monitoring, providing expert and policy advice, and building capacity. A lot of our work has a combination of these functions and different tools, providing better chance for achieving impact and sustainability. Let me start with our work on election, in election observation, well known and there since the very beginning of ODIHR. To date, ODIHR has observed more than 320 elections in 56 out of 57 participating states. Having set a worldwide gold standard in terms of observation methodology, our office continues to develop that methodology further by preparing new thematic tools on issues like gender, minorities, persons with disabilities in the electoral process. There is also an election observer training in person and online. In 2012, we launched an e-learning course for short-term observers. In 2015, we upgraded that course to cover also long-term observers and to run it in a more up-to-date, mobile-friendly way. And today, more than 5,000 participants from more than 150 countries completed the course, the e-course, and obtained certificates. This includes representatives of almost all OSCE participating states and all of the OSCE partners for cooperation. Each observation mission, whatever the format, produces a final report that contains recommendations, providing grounds for follow-up with a view of improving the electoral process in the participating state concerned. ODIHR is able and increasingly aims to assist with that follow-up, for example, through legislative support and expert advice, complementing monitoring with other core ODIHR functions. Let me give you another example of an area in which ODIHR has created a solid methodology. In 2006, we started developing a program to train the police to recognize and respond to hate crime. The program, which is today known as TACLE, Training Against Hate Crime for Law Enforcement, assists participating states to strengthen their response to hate crime. 11 OSCE participating states have committed to implement the program, and we work actively with 6 more participating states who are interested in TACLE. A good example of combining analytical work and capacity building is our gender audit methodology. Since 2014, ODIHR has worked to develop the self-assessment approach to assess internal political party processes, procedures, structures, culture, and activities from a gender perspective to identify and address discriminatory practices. The gender audit process equips political party leadership with the necessary information to adjust political party policies, programs, and campaign strategies as regards to gender equality, revealing strengths and shortcomings, and supporting the development of political party gender action plans. The gender methodology has so far been successfully piloted with major political parties in Armenia, Georgia, and Tajikistan. Gender audit reports were used by political parties in the development of 10 comprehensive party gender action plans, which are currently being used to increase women's political participation. Similarly, various tools are used in ODIHR's work with human rights defenders. Our office has assisted participating states in fulfilling their commitments to protect human rights defenders and enable their important work. In 2014, following an extensive and inclusive consultation process, we published the guidelines on the protection of human rights defenders. We are now actively promoting their implementation by raising awareness of relevant standards among state authorities, national human rights institutions, and civil society, promoting dialogue between state and human rights defenders, and monitoring the implementation of standards across the OSCE region. ODIHR was also instrumental in developing, at the policy and practical level, the concept of national referral mechanisms, a cooperative framework through which state actors fulfill their obligations to protect and promote human rights of trafficked persons in cooperation and partnership with civil society. In 2004, we published a handbook, National Referral Mechanisms, joining efforts to protect the rights of trafficked persons. Now, the National Referral Mechanism concept is widely considered essential to ensure a comprehensive and human rights-based approach to anti-trafficking policies and programs. ODIHR's expertise and advice supported Ukraine's efforts to reform identity management processes. ODIHR has been working closely with the State Migration Service within Ukraine's Interior Ministry since 2015, and our experts assessed the existing procedures for identity management and advised on amendments, helping to align the issuance of identity and travel documents with international standards, one of the EU requirements for visa liberalization. Building on ODIHR's work, Ukrainian authorities introduced the necessary regulations, and in December last year, the European Commission concluded that that security benchmark for passports has been achieved. ODIHR's work on Roma and Sinti issues again demonstrates its multi-layered and building block approach. In 2003, ODIHR's contact point for Roma and Sinti issues embarked for the first time on a big regional project promoting public and electoral participation of the Roma. The three-year program, Roma Use Your Ballot Wisely, implemented in southeastern Europe, aimed at increasing the participation of Roma in public life, promoting dialogue among Roma communities, between Roma and the majority society, and between Roma and authorities, and empowering Roma to be involved in decision-making processes that related to matters of their concern. Today, 10 years later, ODIHR launched the Roma and Sinti Youth Initiative, which is designed to provide opportunities for civic organizations to stimulate Roma and Sinti youth groups as agents of change in their communities. We gave a voice to Roma and Sinti youth and their ideas relating to activism, participation, and security with a publication that was presented last year. We also provided training for Roma youth. These activities helped the international agenda, and this year, in less than 2 weeks from now, the European Commission, together with the European Union Slovak Chairmanship, will host a Roma Youth Conference, which will further strengthen the role of Roma and Sinti youth as agents of change for their communities. ODIHR will continue supporting Roma and Sinti youth, including with a small grant scheme titled For Roma, with Roma, to promote public and political participation and enhancing security of Roma and Sinti communities. Many of you attended on Wednesday evening in the Polin Museum the launch of our three-year project, Turning Words into Action. This ambitious project is not a one-off, but fits squarely under the long-standing program of combating discrimination and raising awareness through education. For example, since 2005, ODIHR has been working in collaboration with the Anne Frank House on the development of teaching tools to combat anti-Semitism. Until now, the program has been implemented in 14 countries, and the latest memorandum of understanding to prepare the teaching materials on combating anti-Semitism has been signed with the authorities of Serbia last year. My colleague Christina Finch will in a few minutes talk about another topic in tolerance and discrimination portfolio of our office. And finally, I would like to briefly lead up to the next presentation of Ambassador Verba. We are very grateful that he has agreed to help us address one of the most frequently asked questions of the past year. How does ODIHR cooperate with the project coordinator in Ukraine and also with the special monitoring mission? And how do we work together? I would like to say a few words about the project our office has been implementing since last year, strengthening dialogue among civil society and with key government stakeholders on human dimension issues in Ukraine. Through this project, we have utilized our regional expertise and diverse project management experience to build capacity, promote dialogue, and support action between civil society organizations and state representatives, to enhance mechanisms for dialogue, to address key human rights issues in Ukraine. Some of the ongoing activities include capacity building of newly emerged human rights organizations from across Ukraine in human rights monitoring, training and opportunities for dialogue and joint initiatives to civil society and criminal justice representatives in the area of hate crimes, support for human rights impact assessment of legislation, and working to build a strong coalition of civil society, politicians, public officials, and international actors in support of parliamentary ethics dialogue. One of the key strengths of the project is a strong focus on partnership that brings together ODIHR, state and non-state stakeholders with complementary resources and expertise and enable wider scope and coverage of activities. ODIHR's cooperation with the OSCE Project Coordinator's Office in Ukraine, for example, on integration of public consultation in lawmaking, is an example that underlines the complementarity of OSCE institutions and structures. And with this, I would like to thank you for your attention now, but also for reflecting on and celebrating with us the 25th anniversary of our office throughout this meeting and on multiple occasions before that. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Katarzyna, for the selection of highlights, which I believe illustrates very well the range and scope of ODIHR engagement over the past 25 years. And as you have mentioned, our next introducer is Ambassador Vaidotas Verba, the OSCE Project Coordinator in Ukraine. Again, somebody who probably needs a little introduction, but I'll still say a few words. Ambassador Verba of Lithuania assumed the responsibilities of OSCE Project Coordinator in Ukraine on the 1st of September 2014. Before that, he was team leader of the Odessa group of the OSCE Special Monitoring Mission in 2014. Between 2012 and 2014, he was special envoy for the EU's partnership at the Ministry of Foreign Affairs of Lithuania, and also chief coordinator for the preparation of the Third Eastern Partnership Summit in Vilnius in the autumn of 2013. From 2007 to 2012, he was ambassador of Lithuania to the Netherlands, and permanent representative to the Organization for the Prohibition of Chemical Weapons. Ambassador Verba, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Chair, for the nice introduction. So, Excellencies, dear guests, it's really my pleasure to highlight today a few of the areas of cooperation between my office, the project coordinator in Ukraine, and the Office of Democratic Institutions and Human Rights, our wonderful host for this event. Each OSCE institution and the field mission has a unique mandate. This at times may hinder coordination. A simple example of that, ODIHR does not provide election assistance, and it might present a conflict of interest, while the PCU has a large project to help Ukraine improve its administration of elections. Yet we have no mandate to conduct monitoring. It therefore may surprise some of you to learn that the original purpose of my office was to facilitate cooperation between the OSCE and its institutions and the Ukrainian governmental and non-governmental partners, as stated in the 1999 Memorandum of Understanding establishing the PCU. I think so. We're supposed to have some kind of slides, just which would be helpful to you just to commemorate what I'm saying. The original mission was to a degree taken over by the PCU's own projects, and today no one, first of all myself, would ever presume that the PCU should attempt to intermediate between the Ukraine and other OSCE structures or institutions. Yet, the need for coordination and assistance has only grown since 2014. Speaking only about my office, our profile has increased exponentially, and as the Ukrainian government and civil society are working across many fronts to strengthen adherence to OSCE commitments and naturally see the PCU as a partner in this endeavor. Likewise, the contribution of other OSCE institutions and executive structures has similarly increased. Some of you may have heard of the Special Monitoring Mission. I am proud that the PCU played such a constructive role in 2014 in ensuring a quick launch and continues to work every day with our colleagues in that mission. I'm also pleased that we were able to provide regular assistance to other structures and institutions, including providing administrative support to ODIHR's dedicated project for Ukraine. To help foster this cooperation, in our 2017 unified budget proposal, I have explicitly set the cross-cutting objective to align and coordinate wherever possible with other OEC offices and international donors and organizations. And we have introduced mechanisms to make this goal a reality. For example, by introducing in project proposals a section describing how the project aligns with the other OEC actors. This coordination is required by the participating states. In nearly every meeting I have met with you, the ambassadors, I'm asked how we are cooperating with the other OEC actors. I welcome these questions. These partnerships are truly useful as they take advantage of our comparative strength. My office, the BCU, Project Coordinator's Office, has project management capacity and long-standing partnerships among a wide range of Ukrainian institutions. ODIHR and the other institutions bring essential international experience and expertise and norms setting. I'd like to outline four specific current examples of how this cooperation works in reality. Next slide. First, is in promoting a public consultations in government policy setting. We had a side event on this team last week, attended by Alice Thomas of ODIHR, Ambassador Prokofchuk of Ukraine, Rostislav Pavlenko, a deputy head of the President Administration of Ukraine, and others. So this information may be redundant for those who were there during the side event. Nevertheless, the PCU is supporting a working group to draft a law on public consultations and on training government and civil society representatives throughout the country in making greater use of consultative mechanisms. ODIHR, from its side, provided an excellent practical review of the draft law and is drafting a handbook for how such consultations can be practically implemented based on international practice. Second, the PCU is training civil society in monitoring administrative trials. Our training is based on ODIHR's methodology, and rather than reinventing the wheel, we translated ODIHR's manual into the Ukrainian and then developed a shorter guide based on largely ODIHR's approach as well as experience of other field missions. Third, the PCU provides commentary on laws and consultative opinions when ODIHR is unable to do so because of its workload. In a recent case, the Constitutional Court of Ukraine found that the requirement for religious gatherings to first obtain permission was unconstitutional. In its ruling, the court cited both the PCU's consultative opinion and the Joint ODIHR-Venice Commission guidelines on freedom of peaceful assembly. Fourth, in the area of human rights education, PCU is helping the Ministry of Education and Science entirely revise law school education and also to introduce a comprehensive human rights-based approach in the schools. This September, we helped introduce a new course on basic law for 10th and 11th graders. The course reaches more than 400,000 students and uses a case study, interactive approach, and follows the ODIHR guidelines on human rights education for secondary school system from 2012. Unfortunately, since those guidelines were written, ODIHR no longer works in the area, but ODIHR is providing human rights training for civil society in Ukraine, an area where it can well draw on extensive experience and expertise, and where PCU does not have a programming. Both PCU and ODIHR are assisting the ombudsperson, with the PCU concentrating its assistance on national preventive mechanism against torture and ill treatment of custodial settings. And ODIHR is concentrating on hate crimes and freedom of religion or belief. Your Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, what these examples have in common is that partnerships strengthen our comparative strengths. and advantages. The PCU is on the ground and has a network of partnerships that we have formed over the last 16 years. ODIHR has international experience and world-class expertise. When we marry these two on the common project and the common project management, I believe the OSCE becomes much more effective in both responding flexibly and quickly in a dynamic environment, while adding its unique value. Thank you very much for your kind attention, and thank you, Director Link and your team, for the excellent cooperation. And my congratulations also on another excellent human dimension implementation meeting. Thank you very much indeed.
Thank you very much, Ambassador Verba. I think it was particularly useful to hear about a few very concrete examples of cooperation between the project coordinator and ODIHR, and indeed hopefully help address this very often heard question on how exactly we work together. I think we talked so far mostly about the past and the present. I think the next presentation is mostly looking forward. So I would like now to introduce the next and the final introducer, our colleague Christina Finch, the head of ODIHR's Tolerance and Non-Discrimination Department. But I'd like to say a few words more to introduce you properly. Christina is a former managing director for the Identity and Discrimination Unit at Amnesty International USA and adjunct law professor at George Mason University School of Law. Prior to joining Amnesty International in October 2009, she served as senior counsel to the Human Rights Campaign, where she focused on the issue of hate violence. Before that, she served as legislative counsel to U.S. Congressman Alcee L. Hastings and as House Legal Counsel to the National Congress of the Republic of Palau. She has testified on legal and policy issues before the UN Human Rights Council, the World Bank, and the U.S. Congress. Christina, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Luke, for that kind introduction. Dear colleagues, good morning. And thank you for this opportunity to present the Tolerance and Non-Discrimination's new project on hate crimes. Participating states have adopted a robust set of decisions on addressing hate crime. But behind the language of those decisions, behind the long list of technical commitments of states to adopt laws, to train police, to collect data, behind all of this are the victims of hate crime, people who have suffered at the hands of those who have committed bias-motivated crime. These victims are looking to the police, to prosecution services, and to judges for support and protection. They're looking to see if they will be made to suffer injustice again, this time from the hands of OSCE governments, which do not live up to those commitments on hate crime. Ours is an urgent mission. ODIHR has worked on hate crimes for many years now. We've made a name for ourselves and helped shape the landscape of hate crime policy. We're considered a European leader on providing technical assistance on hate crimes, and we've proven that we can deliver concrete results to states. But the OSCE region is large, the problem is huge, and we are small, and our resources are finite. That's why we have to be smart. That's why we always look to multiply our messages. That's why we train the trainers rather than end users. That's why we work to improve policies rather than to fix individual instances. And that's why we join forces with the EU and other intergovernmental organizations. Our side event at the HDIN this week on intergovernmental organizations' response to hate crimes underscored the collaboration between ODIHR and ECRI, FRA, the EC, and the European Parliament to make the most effective use of resources to address bias-motivated violence. And that's why I'm here today, to tell you about a project that does precisely that, works effectively with other intergovernmental organizations, and brings our solutions closer to those thousands of victims which are waiting for their governments to deal with the injustice that they have suffered. The name of the two-year project is Building a Comprehensive Criminal Justice Response to Hate Crime. And that's what the project will do. Fill the gaps in government's response to hate crimes to create a holistic and cohesive set of tools for governments to adopt to address hate crime. To put together the project, we joined with the UN High Commissioner for Refugees, the International Association of Prosecutors, the Greek Ministry of Justice, the Polish Office of the Commissioner for Human Rights, the Catholic University of the Sacred Heart in Milan, and the Bulgarian General Prosecutor's Office and National Institute of Justice. The project has already seen a success. It was recently selected by the European Commission for funding, and we are talking with the EU's Fundamental Rights Agency about how to work together on the data collection aspect. The EC will fund 80% of the project, and ODIHR will now work to raise the remaining 20% through EXB funding. The project unites ODIHR's unique experience in training on hate crimes and broad regional reach with the long-term peer group connections of the EU and the International Association of Prosecutors, and finally, with the global coverage of the UNHCR. The project works like this. Partners in four countries, Poland, Bulgaria, Greece, and Italy, have identified challenges that their national criminal justice systems face when responding to hate crime. These are the issues that we will work to address in each of our partner countries. This work on a national level, something my department does on a regular basis, is just the beginning. We will use the lessons from this work and translate them into methodologies, manuals, and guidelines, which will provide guidance to all OSCE countries facing similar challenges. So what specific issues does the project address? Well, the project will develop a victimization survey to measure unreported hate crime. We will create guidance on how to respond to hate crime regionally or locally without waiting for the national government to step in. We will create tools enhancing collaboration of police and prosecutors on hate crime cases. And finally, we will draft strategic guidance on how to formulate national policies on hate crimes. All of these have been requested of us from participating states in the past. All of these will better complement ODIHR's toolbox on hate crimes and help ODIHR better respond to the needs of states. This work is a concrete example of intergovernmental organizations coming together to draw upon each other's strengths and not only provide their participating states with the best value for their money, but also to make a real difference to states grappling with the scourge of bias-motivated violence in their communities. Earlier this week, we held our first coordination meeting with our implementing partners. One of the most pressing questions we heard, can we start sooner? But most importantly, OSCE participating states will be able to use these products on their own without further assistance to make a real difference in the struggle against hate crime. It's your answer to the victims of hate crime and the realization of the political commitments you've already made. We start work on this project in February of 2017. Thank you.
Thank you, Christina, for this very comprehensive picture of this upcoming project. And of course, wishing you all the best with both this hate crime response project and the large anti-Semitism project. It's certainly going to be a very busy 2017 and 2018. So with that, we are ready to open the floor. We still have, well, we actually have five speakers on the list right now, so we can allow a speaking time of 4 minutes. So just would like to quickly remind again that when speaking, if you could please introduce yourself and state the name of the organization, delegation, or institution that you represent. So with that, we could start. The first speaker on the list is Ireland on behalf of the EU, followed by Armenia. Ireland, you have the floor.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator, for giving me the floor. In fact, if, as you say, we're the Tour de France entering the Champs-Élysées, you've given me the yellow jersey. And I'm speaking on behalf of a whole peloton, namely the European Union. And a number of other participating states have aligned themselves with my statement. I'll just read out the list briefly. Turkey, former Yugoslav Republic of Macedonia, Montenegro, Albania, Bosnia and Herzegovina, Liechtenstein, Norway, Ukraine, Moldova, Georgia, and Andorra. The background to our activities in the human dimension has been changing over the past few years. In some participating states, we're further away than before from full respect for fundamental freedoms, including media freedom. In other participating states, democratic institutions are strong, but many people are skeptical about the capacity of public institutions to provide effective responses to their concerns. In several parts of the region, we see random acts of violence and dangerous examples of intolerance. At this year's HDIM, we've paid particular attention to the UN's covenants. The OSCE, with its comprehensive approach and as a regional security organization in the sense of Chapter 8 of the Charter, is well placed to understand that respect for human rights and accountable democratic government are the path to socially cohesive, secure societies. As we're meeting in Warsaw, the European Union wishes in particular to thank Michael Link and his team for their commitment and creativity in the face of challenging circumstances. The role of ODIHR will become more important in the years ahead. We have a number of recommendations to make, and I'll give them in summary form. A slightly longer version of my text will be available. One, participating states should take advantage of the services offered by OSCE executive structures. We in the EU have benefited greatly, and we will benefit, for example, from the project on bias-motivated violence that has just been outlined by Christina Finch. Two, participating states should ensure the timely adoption of the OSCE unified budget. Three, we should coordinate closely with other international actors, and we've just heard a superb illustration of this in the presentation by Christina Finch. Four, when designing projects and activities, executive structures should foster close collaboration with civil society. And five, we should continue to improve the evaluation of projects. Mr. Moderator, the EU strongly supports the mandates of ODIHR, RFOM, and HCNM. I've already referred to ODIHR. The RFOM has been consistent in highlighting failures in implementing our media freedom commitments, in stressing the dangers posed to journalists, in drawing attention to the phenomena of propaganda and disinformation, and in addressing new challenges to the independent role of the media. The HCNM continues to play a vital role in identifying and addressing short-term triggers of inter-ethnic tension, as well as long-term structural concerns. It goes without saying that the European Union strongly supports field activities, field presences, and project work. We would like to highlight in particular, among all the many things that could be said here, the valuable work of the OSCE executive structures in response to the crisis in and around Ukraine. This refers to ODIHR, the RFOM, and the Project Coordinator's Office. We're very glad to have heard from Ambassador Verba just now. It refers to the HCNM and it refers to the SMM. Confidence building is part of the SMM's mandate, and this contributes to creating a safe and secure environment for the monitors. Finally, I would like to underline the important role of the Human Dimension Committee, this year under the able chairmanship of Ambassador Perman of Finland. In some areas, such as the rights of persons with disabilities, the Human Dimension Committee has increased OSCE dialogue in recent months. In other areas, such as freedom of thought, conscience, religion, and belief, the HDC has deepened our understanding of the issues in a potentially fruitful way. The preamble to the Universal Declaration describes respect for human rights as the foundation of freedom, justice, and peace. That, Mr. Moderator, is the spirit in which the European Union approaches the work of the third dimension. Thank you.
Thank you very much. The next speaker is Armenia, followed by Ukraine. Armenia, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. We thank distinguished introducers for outlining their current activities and plans for future. We would like to stress that Armenian government has continuously expressed its political support to the ODIHR, RFOM and HCNM, and cooperated with them on implementation of its human dimension commitments. The Armenian authorities have developed direct, high-level dialogue with the ODIHR and the RFOM, which is another indication of our political will to use these valuable tools. Participation of my country in the HDM at the level of minister is illustrative in this regard. Owing to strong ownership, openness, and constructive attitude of the government of Armenia towards OSCE institutions, a number of events, training courses, field visits are being organized in Armenia on a regular basis, which are of great assistance for my country in raising its democratic profile, ensuring human rights and fundamental freedoms for our society, and strengthening the rule of law. In exercising their activities, the OSCE institutions should develop stronger cooperation with the OSCE field missions, which are invaluable tools on the ground, in particular when it comes to assessment of the progress of participating states in implementation of their commitments. We encourage the institutions to be more active in utilization of their early warning mandate and preventive diplomacy. The projects of ODIHR, RFOM, and HCNM should be streamlined in a way to promote confidence and trust between participating states and peoples. Another important factor of efficiency of a project is its inclusivity. We regret to note that a significant part of the population in the OSCE area is excluded from the activities of the OSCE institutions, namely people living in conflict zones. Problems of status should not be an obstacle for the institutions to refuse cooperation with the relevant authorities and civil societies in conflict areas. Let's not forget that our institutions are dealing with human rights issues, and all people in the OSCE area are entitled to their individual and collective human rights and fundamental freedoms, regardless status of their territory. I would like to recall the UN motto, all human rights for all and nobody should be left behind. We would like to share some concerns in regard to project work of our institutions. The primary value and cornerstone of OSCE institutions is their impartiality, non-selectivity, and objectivity. We believe that the agenda of their activities should be solely human rights based and in no way promote conflict interests and perception of one participating state against the other. Attempts to create artificial balance between participating states with the aim to appease and engage those who are not willing to engage is another worrying trend which affects negatively the credibility of our institutions. Such attempts are even more disturbing when, in the name of balancing, equality mark is put between those who comply with the OSCE human dimension commitments and those who openly challenge them. We are not going to follow these examples and adopt the same rules of game, but we will not accept abuse of our constructive attitude and attempts to reward certain participating states at the expense of our national interests and OSCE values. We stand ready to continue cooperation with the OSCE institutions within our policy of further implementing OSCE commitments, including strengthening democracy, rule of law, and human rights in Armenia. Thank you very much, Mr. Moderator.
Thank you for your comments and recommendations. The next speaker is Ukraine, followed by the Russian Federation. Ukraine, you have the floor.
Тарасенко Константин, Национальная полиция Украины, делегация.
I'm from the National Police of Ukraine and the delegation. Good morning, participants. I'd like to express my gratitude to ODIHR and also on behalf of Ukraine. And also, I'd like to directly thank the project coordinator of the OSCE in Ukraine. At the moment, we have a number of important projects in the area of protecting human rights, which are being implemented in Ukraine with the coordination of ODIHR. I would also like to directly thank you on behalf of the National Police of Ukraine for your assistance in protecting human rights. Together with OSCE, we're implementing the following project, for a training course to prevent human trafficking and prevent violence. More than 2,800 people, officers from a number of towns across Ukraine have participated in this. Together with the representative from the Department for counteracting human trafficking, together with Italy and Austria, we have been implementing a plan to prevent human trafficking. Material has been prepared, and we are working on training staff with 28 regional police centers across Ukraine. More than 1,000 staff are participating. We're also looking at beginning a training process on plans to increase the level of qualification of new staff. We're also working on training new inspectors and agents for the police. There's a 4-month training program also for those working in the cyber security department. We're also developing a diplomatic plan on counteracting human trafficking together with the National Police of Ukraine. We were also developing methodological recommendations for police being involved in schools, particularly preventing problems amongst children of school age. The project coordinator in Ukraine is supporting the development of teaching programs and materials, and also the program on training more than 11,000 staff, patrol officers, and 400 cyber police officers, and a number of specialists on human trafficking, the focus on human rights, tolerance, non-discrimination, and the participation of police in the community has allowed us to ensure that victims have their rights respected. At the same time, there's work between various sections and departments to assist citizens as much as possible. We are also hoping that a close cooperation will continue on these various projects that I mentioned, and we hope that new projects will be developed between the OSCE and the National Police in Ukraine on gender equality, hate crime, and cooperation between the police and Sinti and Roma communities. I'd once again like to thank the representatives of the OSCE for their assistance and their assistance in reforming the National Police, which is now being transformed into a real law enforcement agency and a protector of human rights. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Our next and final speaker is the Russian Federation. Russian Federation, you have the floor.
Thank you, moderator. Chairman, dear colleagues, in the course of this meeting, the discussion has shed light on many of the outstanding problems in the human dimension in the OSCE area. In our organization and its structures, there is still a lot of margin for improving the effectiveness of our work, both in terms of a more comprehensive encompassing of the entire Euro-Atlantic area and also in achieving a better thematic balance or equilibrium. Within the OSCE, the work of the executive structures continues to be insufficiently transparent. We must remember that the OSCE's executive structures are not subcontractors with individual orders to fill, but rather instruments of cooperation among all 57 participating states in the fulfillment of concrete commitments they have signed up to. It is unacceptable for executive structures not to implement the decisions of the OSCE's governing bodies or for them to provide incomplete information to participating states about their activities in their work. The executive structures should follow only such approaches as are based on a consensus among OSCE participating states. The aim is to bring state positions closer together, not to sharpen differences amongst them. The statements of many participants in the meeting show that there is no single region in the OSCE that doesn't have serious problems with a wide spectrum of within the human dimension. And this underscores the need to have an equal understanding within executive structures over the entire area, and not just in politically convenient countries and regions. It is quite unacceptable that the OSCE has de facto removed itself from trying to solve the huge migration problem with which Europe is now confronted. The migration crisis has brought about a degradation in the level of human rights implementation and has become a real threat to security on the European continent. The OSCE's executive structures have turned out to be incapable of an impartial analysis of massive violations of human rights, including the right to life in Ukraine. The High Commissioner for National Minorities and ODIHR continue obstinately to ignore the status of non-citizens in Latvia and Estonia, which is something quite shameful in today's Europe. All OSCE structures must pay serious and unflagging attention to the rise in manifestations of neo-Nazism aggressive nationalism and intolerance on national and religious and ethnic grounds. A subject of some importance for OSCE structures is the defense of the rights of believers in combating intolerance in their respect. It has been necessary for a long time to pay more attention to the protection of children, which has now been included among the specially selected themes of the present meeting. We cannot consider the actions of the OSCE to protect journalists to be satisfactory. The executive structures should be operational in their reactions to cases of violation of journalists' rights and obstruction of their activities, all the more so when their lives and health are under attack. The current scandal concerning the television channel 112 Ukraine and the recent arson attack on the inter-channel building in Kiev show that much remains to be done within the OSCE to develop a respectful approach to the work of the media in all participating states. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much. I think we have now reached the end of the speakers list. I believe we do not have requests for right of reply. We still have some time, so we can accommodate that. If not, then it's left for me to thank you all for your expressions of support, but also your comments and recommendations on the topic of this session. I would really like to thank the three introducers for providing a nice kaleidoscope of project work, not only in audio, but also in a field operation. I would, of course, like to thank the interpreters for the continued excellent work, and also my colleagues left and right and behind me for supporting me during this session. There's one announcement to make. Since we are finishing this session a bit early, there's a proposal to reconvene at 11:15 instead of 11:30, since the final session is a bit more packed in terms of speakers, so we could break now and then reconvene at 11:15. Director, I mean, give the floor to Director Link.
But of course, there would also be, let me simply ask you, and really I don't want not to make confusion, I want to ask you, if you want so, we can also continue immediately. And of course, we agree together, of course, that we end a little bit earlier. I think that would be maybe, I see a lot of heads nodding. Of course, we should give 1 minute to inform those who maybe wanted to join only at 11:30, but I think it would be good to save a little bit of time, okay? Anything against that?
Well, just I'm not sure that I'm not.
Okay, so please, in this case, I would kindly ask our team to inform ambassadors who are outside, to inform them that we begin a little bit earlier, but I think all ambassadors know, also from Vienna, from the PC, that we always need to be flexible in delegacy meetings, and we continue right away. Okay? Thank you. Okay.
Thank you very much. With this we can close working session 18. Thank you very much.
So thank you very, very, very much also for all of your flexibility. I thank especially Luc and his team. By the way, what he's doing as project coordinator, as ODIHR, with his team is excellent, and we rely very much, of course, on his work. Also, thank you very much from my side to the introducers, Vytautas Verba, Christina Finch, and of course, last not least, ODIHR's first deputy director, Katarzyna Jaroszewicz-Wargan, who is doing a great job as first deputy director. Dear participants, we are now, after all these working sessions and after this last working session of this morning, we are now proceeding to the official closing session. And let me remind you that, as always in the official closing, only the participating states have the right to speak, to take the floor. The representatives of civil society, of course, as always, most welcome. But here we come now back to the more formal part of the closing, and this is reserved, as always, to the participating states. We will have, first of all, the possibility for you, for the delegations, to take the floor for your statements. Let me remind you, speakers list is behind me. We already have some, but of course, it's still open. Please let us know if you want to take the floor. After that, after the statements of the delegations, we will have the right of reply, as always, followed by our usual point, any other business. And after that, of course, we will have the closing remarks first by the Secretary General of the OSCE. And let me use this opportunity to warmly welcome Lamberto Zanier here at the Human Dimension Implementation Meeting. As you know, he was excused for good reasons in the opening where he was, and maybe he will also tell us about, of course, about the very important side event at the United Nations General Assembly Plenary Debate in New York. We are therefore very glad that he is with us today for the closing remarks. His remarks will be followed by the closing remarks of the German chairmanship, where Ambassador Eberhard Pohl will give us the closing remarks on behalf of Gernot Erler, who is unfortunately not able to come in person today, but his remarks will be given to us by Ambassador Eberhard Pohl. And finally, followed by my own closing remarks, and then let us end indeed a little bit earlier than foreseen. I think everybody certainly, after these 2 weeks of work, will be also happy maybe to join, of course, also the private life a little bit earlier, if possible. Having said that, any questions from your side regarding how we will work in this closing session, if there is anything clear from your side? If not, okay, very good, I've noted that. Let me come to the first statements of the delegations, and let me ask who is first on the list. Thank you, Rita. We have, I will briefly read you what we have as statements already right now, and later give you, as always, the two next ones. We have first Slovakia on behalf of the European Union, followed by Armenia, United States of America, Turkey, Russian Federation, Switzerland, Norway, Ukraine, Austria. So far, that is what we have, and also Poland. List is still open, and we begin, therefore, with the statement of Slovakia on behalf of also speaking on behalf of the European Union, and therefore I pass the floor to the distinguished representative of Slovakia and the European Union. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Ambassador.
The floor is yours.
Beche was supposed to read our closing statement, but
if you want, we can wait until he comes. But simply let me know. But of course, you are most welcome to read it.
Maybe you can give the floor to the next
one.
Yes,
no problem. Absolutely no problem. With pleasure. That is why I asked in the beginning if it's okay that we begin a little bit earlier, but I think we are flexible for that to wait until Ambassador is back. So it's my pleasure now. Of course, we hand over. The first statement in this case will be by the distinguished representative of Armenia. The floor is yours.
Thank you, distinguished director. We thank the German chairmanship for successful conduct of 2016 Human Dimension Implementation Meeting. Our thanks also go to the ODIHR and particularly Polish government for its traditional hospitality. Being the most important human dimension event of the OSCE, the HDM brought together representatives of governments of participating states, our partners for cooperation, civil society and academia, and provided forum for inclusive dialogue. We engaged in open debate on current challenges in the sphere of human rights, our achievements and best practices in upholding OSCE commitments, but also we did not shy away to address our own shortcomings and outstanding issues. The discussions once again clearly established the fact that security and stability in the OSCE area is closely interlinked with upholding of human rights and fundamental freedoms. Participants of HDIM agreed that gross violation of human rights and fundamental freedoms may further fuel conflicts. The delegation of Armenia outlined the urgent need to address gross violation of human rights of population living in conflict areas which are deprived of international protection. We highlighted recent cases of torture, mutilation and killing of civilians and military servicemen in the NKA conflict zone. We stressed that OSCE institutions should take up and streamline the topic of protection of rights of persons living in conflict areas in their agenda. The discussions revealed that there is a vicious cycle of human rights violations when large-scale domestic crackdown on fundamental freedoms is reinforced by atrocities perpetrated within protracted conflicts. Sadly, this vicious cycle of promoting and justifying violence takes its toll on human lives. It also undermines cooperative security in the OSCE area and constitutes a regional threat, which we have to address as a result of violent actions of Azerbaijan. The value of HDIM is dialogue among participating states and civil society. The delegation of Armenia tried to engage in dialogue with representatives of NGOs, including from Armenia, in good faith and in result-oriented manner. We again regret that certain participating states restricted participation of the independent civil society and tried to silence dissenting voices even here in the HDIM, and yet came here with number of gongos. This is disrespectful towards all of us who value the HDIM as one of the most inclusive platforms for human rights dialogue in the world. Let's not fake it. Last but not least, the delegation of Armenia presented its vision on how to raise the efficiency of the OEC institutions, including ODIHR, in particular to avoid duplication with other international organizations and effectively utilize its early warning and conflict prevention mandate. We reiterate our readiness to further constructive dialogue and cooperation with the OEC institutions and representatives of civil society in order to further improve implementation of our OEC commitments. Thank you very much, Director.
Thank you very much to the delegation of Armenia. The next delegation to take the floor is the distinguished representative of the United States of America, followed by Slovakia also speaking on behalf of the European Union. Please, United States of America, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. As the 2016 HDIM draws to a close, my delegation wishes to share some observations that will shape our approach to the OSCE ministerial in Hamburg. First, Helsinki Final Act principles linking respect for human rights within states to lasting security among states could not be more relevant. These foundational principles are under siege and they must be defended. Second, the breach of these principles has created a degree of insecurity and distrust in this region that is without precedent since the Balkan Wars of the early 1990s. We must always be ready for honest discussions and purposeful cooperation wherever improvements can be made. But diplomatic balancing and institutional adjustments, however creative and well meant, cannot restore security and trust. Security and trust come only from renewed fidelity to the founding principles. Third, no matter how hard Russia tries to gain international legitimacy for its intervention in eastern Ukraine and its occupation of Crimea, and no matter how hard it tries to justify its military support for the separatist enclaves in Georgia, it will fail. The Donbas and Crimea remain parts of Ukraine. Abkhazia and South Ossetia remain parts of Georgia. Threat or use of force will not deter Ukraine, Georgia, and Moldova from their sovereign decisions to deepen their integration with Europe. Fourth, and this bears repeating because we still hear this tired accusation from a number of participating states. When a fellow state or a human rights defender or an NGO or a journalist criticizes the human rights record of a particular country, this does not constitute interference in internal affairs. As we all affirmed at Astana, human dimension commitments are matters of direct and legitimate concern to all participating states and do not belong exclusively to the internal affairs of the state concerned. No government secure in its democratic legitimacy would be frightened by efforts, whether domestic or international, to expose abuses. The record of my own government has been examined and sometimes criticized here by fellow states and civil society members. This is to be expected. We might not always agree with the criticism, but we take it seriously and we try to respond in a serious way. Indeed, my government is among only a handful of represented here that has not acknowledged domestic shortcomings and discussed how we are working to address them. As is our custom, my delegation will report later today on steps we took to fulfill promises we made at last year's HDIM, and we are planning to take additional measures between now and the 2017 HDIM. Fifth, the participation of HDIM of independent civil society members is essential to the quality and integrity of our discussions. Your contributions provide ground truth, deepen our understanding, and help us find practical solutions to problems. You add a vital human element. I was particularly moved by the pleas on behalf of Crimean journalist Mykola Semena, who faces criminal charges for calls for undermining Russian territorial via mass media. He is in ill health and banned from leaving occupied Crimea. We urge Russia to permit Semena to travel to Kyiv for medical treatment. And my delegation made a special point of reaching out to Azerbaijani journalist Ismailova, though through the power of technology, since she was prevented from traveling here. These and other personal encounters put a human face on the disturbing trends we see in the region. Six, setbacks for democracy, human rights, and rule of law have worsened since the last HDIM. During the 2 weeks we've been deliberating, the leadership of the Republika Srpska held a referendum in direct contravention of a decision by the Constitutional Court of Bosnia-Herzegovina, undermining the rule of law and obstructing implementation of the Dayton Peace Accords. Officials in Hungary's parliament reportedly attempted to launch security investigations into NGOs in retaliation for their criticism of the government's anti-migrant campaign. Russia's Supreme Court upheld the ban of the Crimean Tatars self-governing body, the Mejlis. Reportedly, the occupation authorities have initiated a criminal case against Nikolai Polozov for his defense of unjustly targeted Crimean Tatars. We repeat, Russia has no authority over Crimea. Within its own territory, Russia has added two more civil society organizations to the foreign agents list, bringing the total to 144. Meanwhile, the Russian delegation persists in making the false claim that their country's repressive foreign agents law is similar to the U.S. Foreign Agents Registration Act, or FARA. It is not. Our law does not penalize those who disagree with our policies or practices, whether they happen to be NGOs or foreign governments. FARA is a public disclosure law. It does not restrict lobbying or advocacy in the United States, nor does it restrict the receipt by NGOs of foreign funding. Unlike Russia, we only require that actual representatives of foreign government register and disclose that they are acting as such. The investigative journalist, Grigory Pasco, with whom my delegation met last week here in Warsaw, was physically attacked in Barnaul, Russia. The NGOs and independent journalists who have enriched our HDIM discussions have the right to return to their own countries. It should be respected without reprisal. Family members of Tajik activists who made presentations in this very hall were reportedly assaulted or threatened in Tajikistan. We are also concerned that the Kyrgyz activists have received threats upon their return. In an attempt to crowd out authentic voices, gongo after gongo has taken the floor here. These gongos and the governments that hand them their talking points spare individuals peacefully exercising their rights as violent extremists or terrorists. We all recognize this ugly practice for what it is, a rationalization for repression. Seventh, the choice between security and liberty is a false choice. Members of civil society need fundamental freedoms to organize themselves against the real violent extremists. Fundamental freedoms are also needed by homegrown political movements to give young people hope that change can be won peacefully. To limit freedoms is to lower our defenses. Eighth, our political leaders bear a very heavy responsibility to confront intolerance across our region. We must condemn and combat hate crimes against Roma, persons of African descent, Jews, Muslims, Christians, and others who are targeted, such as LGBTI individuals, persons with disabilities, and migrants. Peace is threatened when the power of the state is used to stoke hatred. This continent has seen where unchecked hatred leads. It leads to Auschwitz and Babyn Yar. All participating states must reject intolerance and discrimination in all their forms, and we should welcome civil society as our partner in this cause. Ninth, mounting pressure against civil society and independent media is accompanied by efforts to undermine the HDIM and weaken OSCE's independent bodies and field missions. My delegation opposes any shortening of the annual HDIM or any hollowing out of HDIM agendas. We also oppose weakening OSCE institutions. We will work to ensure that fearless people are appointed to High Commissioner on National Minorities, representative of media freedom, freedom of the media, and Office for Democratic Institutions and Human Rights. Any states that hold these key positions hostage cannot claim to act in good faith. Tenth and finally, we will, as we prepare for the Hamburg ministerial, we need to focus on our efforts on defending Helsinki principles, implementing our shared commitments, and strengthening OSCE institutions. There is no other way to rebuild and sustain our common security. On behalf of my delegation, I thank Director Link and his outstanding ODIHR team for so masterfully organizing this premier event for human rights. We extend once again our deep gratitude to the people and government of Poland for hosting ODIHR and for so graciously receiving us at HTM. Thank you very much, Mr. President.
Thank you very much to the delegation of the United States of America. We now come back to the order. Ambassador, sorry, we created maybe a little bit of unexpected situation, but the last session was over earlier and we agreed here. Let's move on. And so now the floor is to you, Ambassador. You have the floor on the for Slovakia and also, of course, especially on behalf of the European Union. The floor is yours.
Let us move on indeed, and thank you for your flexibility. We speak on behalf also of the former Yugoslav Republic of Macedonia and Montenegro, and I expect more participating states to align with us, and the list will be circulated in writing. Mr. Chair, the European Union, actually thank you as representative of ODIHR, but also all of your colleagues in ODIHR who have helped making this big event a big success once again. We want to thank the German chairmanship also for organizing this very valuable meeting. And also we want to thank Poland for hosting us again very graciously and very gracefully. We're all very, very happy with that. We want to thank the human rights defenders, all representatives of civil society and journalists who have actively engaged in the discussion, some of them giving worrying testimonies on their experience and the situation they face in their respective countries. We commend their courage, and we reaffirm our constant commitment to support and protect human rights defenders. HDIM is an opportunity for all of us to be held accountable in relation to our OEC commitments. We, the European Union and its member states, have listened carefully to the concerns and recommendations directed at us. We acknowledge that our own challenges and shortcomings, and we remain committed to addressing them and to continuing a genuine dialogue with independent civil society. HDIM provides also a unique platform to interact with civil society whose independence and work should neither be restricted nor instrumentalized. They are an essential partner for the implementation of human dimension commitments. Regrettably, once more, some participating states prevented civil society representatives from participating in this meeting by imposing travel restrictions. We are concerned by disturbing reports that some states, for instance, Tajikistan and Kyrgyzstan, try to intimidate and punish them or their family members for exercising their rights by taking part in HDIM. We call on all participating states to refrain from such unacceptable actions and abide by their OEC commitments. It is the state's responsibility to ensure that those who speak up for human rights, be it in their own countries or in any international fora, are protected. We also regret that while facing criticism, some participating states have chosen to leave HDIM and not engage further in exchange of the views. And once more, some participating states have chosen to instrumentalize civil society in their attempt to discredit independent voices. We are pleased to see Turkmenistan present again at this HDIM meeting, and we call on the authorities to engage in dialogue with civil society and its citizens, particularly with the families of the so-called disappeared. This year's meeting pointed out the ongoing or even increasing restrictions on civil society and crackdown in human rights and fundamental freedoms in parts of the OEC region. We see a downward trend in this regard across much of Central Asia, Azerbaijan, and Russia. Time and again, we have spoken out against so-called foreign agents and other similar restrictive laws that unjustifiably limit the rights to freedom of association, assembly, and expression, or the use of flawed trials to silence critical voices. Fundamental freedoms must continue to be guaranteed online and offline, even as a state acts to address terrorism threats. Security and human rights go hand in hand. We continue to be alarmed by attacks on journalists and the effect of disinformation campaigns and propaganda on the media space in the OEC region. We believe the EU human rights dialogue processes with all five Central Asian states are a means to further promoting cooperation also in line with all OEC commitments. We share the concerns expressed regarding the human rights situation in areas of eastern Ukraine controlled by Russia-backed separatists and in Crimea, illegally annexed by Russia, in particular the precarious situation of the Crimean Tatars. We remain firm in our non-recognition of the illegal annexation of Crimea and Sevastopol by Russia. which we have constantly repeated during this meeting, as some participants attempted to use a legitimate opportunity for discussion and dialogue and make points relating to a situation that is in contradiction with Helsinki principles. Regarding areas of eastern Ukraine controlled by Russia-backed separatists, we remain firm in our call on all sides to swiftly and fully implement the Minsk agreements and honor their commitments in full. We reiterate our call for full, immediate, and unrestricted access for the OSCE institutions, as well as for other international actors in these areas. We reiterate our unwavering support to Ukraine's sovereignty, territorial integrity, unity, and independence in line with the OSCE principles and commitments. We are equally concerned by the human rights situation in the areas affected by protracted conflicts, and we reiterate that it is in the obligation not only of states, but also of non-state actors and those in control of these areas to guarantee and protect the human rights of all people. We also expressed our concerns that there are ongoing discussions on the need to reintroduce the death penalty. We express our concern regarding Belarus, the only country in Europe still actively applying the death penalty. The European Union opposes the death penalty in all times and in all circumstances, and urge countries applying it to set up a moratorium as a first step towards its abolition. Attention was drawn to the situation in Turkey with regard to rule of law and fundamental freedoms. The EU has a strong commitment to dialogue and common work with Turkey, including ensuring the defense of democratic principles and the respect for human rights and rule of law. The last 2 weeks have proven once more that the OSCE commitments are more relevant than ever, and we call on all participating states to live up to them and reverse existing violations. All participating states must respect the mandates and roles of ODIHR, HCNM, and RFOM as essential instruments in their effort to fulfill their OSCE commitments. We reiterate our constant support for the work and the mandate of all three autonomous institutions. We must also ensure that the OSCE institutions are adequately resourced to play their indispensable role. The meeting has also reminded us of the need to advance efforts in the field of women, peace and security to ensure full gender equality, as well as to fight all forms of discrimination in an inclusive and human rights-based manner. Human rights, fundamental freedoms, rule of law and democratic principles highlighted and discussed during these 2 weeks lie at the core of the OSCE concept of comprehensive security. They remain the focus of European Union as we look towards the upcoming OSCE Ministerial Council. We see the meeting in Hamburg as a good opportunity to take forward the recommendations from our meeting with the aim to reaffirming and strengthening the OSCE human rights dimension commitments. We very much welcome the input of civil society in this regard. This year, we showed great flexibility to compromise with respect to the agenda of this meeting. We know that is without prejudice for the future. Thank you once again to ODIHR, to all those who have helped organizing this meeting, to our host and everybody who contributed to discussions. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Ambassador. The next delegation to take the floor is the distinguished representative of Turkey, followed by the Russian Federation.
Thank you, Mr. Chairperson. I'd like to begin by expressing our thanks and appreciation to you and through you to ODIHR as a whole, as well as to the German chairmanship in office for the excellent organization of this HDIM. Our gratitude also goes to our Polish hosts for their customary gracious hospitality. We thank all participants, particularly the representatives of civil society, for sharing their experiences and concerns and providing many valuable recommendations. Earlier this year, my country was faced with a challenge of the highest gravity to its security and stability. Indeed, the terrorist coup attempt of 15 July targeted in Turkey every embodiment of the democratic notions enshrined in the Helsinki Final Act. The coup plotters massacred the civilians who took to the streets to stand against them. They attacked the presidency and tried to assassinate the president. They used the nation's aircraft to bombard our Grand National Assembly in full knowledge that the democratically elected representatives of the Turkish people were inside. While the coup has been thwarted, we are still in the process of dismantling the networks behind this dastardly plot. As we continue our justified struggle against this threat, we attribute great importance to the support and solidarity of all whom we know to be our friends. Mr. Chairperson, at the 2016 HDIM, we were pleased to take part once again in the intensive and fruitful debates of the various working sessions. Civil society's active and energetic participation was, as ever, of particular significance. Their constructive contributions and recommendations will no doubt benefit the participating states as well as our OSCE institutions, and thus serve to bolster our ongoing common efforts to strengthen and further human rights, fundamental freedoms, and the rule of law throughout the OSCE region. The discussions of the two past weeks should serve to remind us all that, in addition to the urgent problems we continue to face, such as the current refugee and migration crisis, and the many challenges emanating from the crisis in and around Ukraine, with grave consequences for civilian populations, including the Crimean Tatars, far more progress has to be made in the implementation of our human dimension commitments in many areas. We regret, on the other hand, that those who habitually abuse the opportunities granted by human rights and fundamental freedoms to make provocative calls for the restriction of those very rights and freedoms took even broader advantage than usual of the HDIM this year, at times effectively hijacking this platform to propagate their intolerant and offensive views. In particular, the scale assumed by Islamophobia and anti-Muslim sentiment, as well as the undeniable fact that they are still on the rise, was clearly demonstrated during some of the sessions, underpinning the pressing need to effectively combat these phenomena along with other forms of racism, xenophobia, and intolerance. Looking toward the future, this grim picture, of course, highlights the necessity to retain with equal determination the priority accurately placed by the current German OSCE chairmanship on combating intolerance and discrimination. In conclusion, I would like to underline once again the value Turkey ascribes to the HDIM and to reiterate our hope that this year's deliberations and the various recommendations that have ensued from them will contribute to the efforts of all participating states to ensure the full implementation of our shared human dimension commitments. Thank you.
Thank you very much to the delegation of Turkey. The next delegation to take the floor is the Russian Federation, followed by Switzerland. Please, the floor is yours.
Thank you. Director Link, ladies and gentlemen. As in previous years, the discussion of the most important areas in the area of the human dimension at the Warsaw Review meeting have been characterized by a severe politicization. We must express our disappointment with the position of many member states who refuse to recognize that the reason behind the serious crisis in the OSCE area is the irresponsible and aggressive policy of Western politicians against other member states. Our delegation once again would like to call on our Western partners to reject such an unpromising approach through armed affirmation of the geopolitical aims and interference in the internal affairs of sovereign states. The product of such a practice is clearly shown by the current Ukraine crisis. Countries of the West not merely supported, but also proved themselves to be not impartial. The organization in February 2014 of the overthrow of the state in Ukraine and the use of force. The Ukrainian people paid a dilly for the advice of highly placed Washington emissaries and European politicians in the signing of the agreement between the president of the Ukraine, Yanukovych, and the then of opposition. The campaign, which started after the taking by the opposition of power in the country to persecute and destroy people who think differently from them, and the legitimate decision at the beginning of the punishment of punishment operations against the peaceful population in Donbass, who spoke out for the respect of their legitimate rights, led to unprecedented levels of victims in the civilian population. and the perpetrators of these crimes have not yet been brought to justice. In the context of Ukraine, I would like to draw your attention to what we circulated yesterday amongst participants in the meeting, namely a statement on the situation about the television channel 112 Ukraine. We have great concern over the pressure from the Ukrainian authorities on people working at this television channel, its owner, Pub Shipkov. It's clear from the information we have that this media outlet is being made into a pawn in a political game, and it has nothing to do with freedom of expression or standards of journalism. As a result of this, there have been threats against the television channel, and radical forces are preparing for a reckoning. Taking into account this, it is very understandable why the people of Crimea took the brave and far-sighted decision to have a referendum in March 2014 and choose the path of reunification with the Russian Federation, the collective punishment of Crimeans for their free decision. Washington, Brussels, and Kiev have shown them to be have been cynically and contradicting international law. At the same time, the format of our meeting has allowed representatives of the Crimea civil society organizations to share with member states objective information about the situation on the peninsula and reject the propaganda. I must draw your attention to the importance of counteracting ill-intentioned efforts to falsify and rewrite history. We would like to turn to one of the most tragic pages in the history of Europe, whose anniversary we're gradually seeing at the moment. In fact, it was on the 30th of September 1938 when leading European powers concluded a sadly well-known agreement with Adolf Hitler, which was called the Munich Agreement. This shameful step forward of the old European democracies assured the Third Reich of impunity in its aggressive policy and opened the way to the capture of the East and the start of the Second World War. The victory over Nazism came at too high a price, the lives of millions of soldiers and citizens of the anti-Hitler coalition. We call on all of those to present here today to look at what we published today, namely a commentary of the Ministry of Foreign Affairs on this subject. In the interests of peace and security in the OSCE area, we call on the USA, Canada, European Union, Ukraine to review their position with regard to many acts of glorification of Nazism and its followers, marches by veterans of the Waffen-SS, and making a hero out of organizations like OUN and the UPA, and phenomena of neo-Nazism, radical nationalism, and other aggressive ideologies is particularly relevant in the year, which is the 70th anniversary of the rulings of the Nuremberg Trials. Mr. Moderator, there's great concern over the ongoing old and systematic problem of the respect for human rights in the Euro-Atlantic area. A good opportunity to review the obligations of member states in the area of human rights and the human dimension is our in our meeting was a discussion on the 50th anniversary of the International Covenant on Human Rights in 1966. The discussion, once again, showed the double approach of those countries who do not ratify these treaties or they have reservations to them. Together with the legitimate question about how this approach is in line with these countries' agreements under the United Nations Charter, attempts of these countries to continue to take on the role of mentors and legislators in the areas of human rights is at question. So I would once again like to draw attention to the importance of member states of the EU and the USA to be more prepared to for dialogue and cooperation in the area of the human dimension and to stop attacks on sovereign states who are undertaking their own policies. Such a non-constructive approach of Western partners is already led to the degradation of the very idea of human rights protection. Moreover, the OSCE has some serious tasks addressing the issues of migration, of fighting racism, intolerance and discrimination, neo-Nazism, protecting the rights of children, ensuring freedom of religious belief, protecting the rights of believers, and also protecting national minorities and journalists. As regards the migration problem, unfortunately, we haven't heard a clear explanation from representatives of the European Union about how this will be addressed. This is particularly important, taking into account the use of migration flows by international terrorist organizations to get into the European continent. Moreover, we should not forget that the main reason behind this migration crisis in Europe is the irresponsible actions and policy of the United States and its allies aimed at changing political regimes which are not useful to them in countries of the Middle East and North Africa. We proposed that the discussions on sharing the burden with regard to the migration crisis are absolutely have no place here. The current discussion on key problems of our agenda is rich material for further work in and taking further measures. Particularly, we would like to talk about the Basel and Hamburg declarations of the ministerial meeting on counteracting intolerance and discrimination against Christians and Muslims. We believe it's important that decisions be taken about preventing discrimination in sport, in particular against people with disabilities. It would be an appropriate response of the OSCE to the discriminatory treatments of Russian sportsmen in the Rio Olympic and Paralympic Games this year. Sir, I would also like to talk a little bit about the character and methods of our work at our meetings. Not all approved ODIHR organizations should be supported. We call on the ODIHR to give provide an opportunity for experts to circulate their interventions in written form. We do not share the optimism of some states who have already spoken about the success and the great organization of the Warsaw meeting. We wonder how such declarations can be linked back to the fact that two states demonstratively abandoned the forum. We hope that there'll be a change in the style of work of the ODIHR and the other executive structures of the OSCE. There's a need for to consider reform. There needs to be a stepping up of work on addressing problems in the OSCE area, in particular in countries to the west of Vienna. As regards the OSCE as a whole, at the basis of our approach is consensus, and we would like to say that this has in fact become the victim of certain political approaches. The Russian delegation is certain the OSCE should make a useful contribution to international cooperation in the humanitarian dimension. We are ready to actively cooperate with all constructive efforts. The main task, we believe, is returning the OSCE the role of a unique forum for equal and mutually respectful dialogue and collective decision-making on relevant issues in ensuring security in the region. Thank you very much for your attention.
I do thank the distinguished representative of the Russian Federation. Next delegation to take the floor is the distinguished representative of Switzerland, followed by Norway.
Merci.
Thank you, Director. Switzerland would like to thank the Office of Democratic Institutions and Human Rights and its director, the deputy director, and all of the staff for the excellent organization of this conference on implementation of the human dimension. And this despite the very tight deadlines because of the tardy adoption of the agenda. The meeting shows once again that this conference remains a cornerstone when it comes to integration of civil society. It's a platform of exchange and of essential dialogue, and it is a barometer of the space given to civil society and its vitality within the OSCE. Our discussions show the importance of the contribution by civil society that is independent and critical to the implementation of human rights. However, Switzerland is very concerned by the repressive measures, even measures of retribution, taken against human rights defenders by several participating states. In particular, Switzerland is very concerned by the repression exercised by the authorities of Tajikistan against members of families of representatives of the Islamic Renaissance Party of Tajikistan after a peaceful demonstration to support the victims held by these family members, to support these victims of judicial sentences handed down against them, sentences about which Switzerland has already expressed its concern on several occasions. Switzerland is also concerned by the threats made against Tolikan Ismailova and Aziza Abdurasulova and measures announced against them by the authorities of Kyrgyzstan following their participation in discussions in this very room. Switzerland calls on all participating states to guarantee the protection of human rights defenders and to give them the conditions they need for pluralism of opinion in accordance with international obligations and commitments to which they have subscribed. It is not acceptable that obstacles be raised to the activities of civil society within the very heart of this conference, whose objective it is to enshrine a dialogue on an equal footing between civil society and participating states. But setting these challenges aside, Switzerland welcomes the holding of very good discussions on subjects with respect to which the OSCE has a strategic position for the protection of human rights, and with respect to which we must intensify our efforts. Numerous side events organized during these 2 weeks have been an opportunity for stimulating an in-depth exchange on subjects that show how much work needs to be done within the whole OSCE area in order to strengthen the implementation of human rights. Finally, in the perspective of the Ministerial Council to be held in Hamburg, Switzerland encourages continuation of work with a view to adopting an addendum to the OSCE Action Plan on Gender Issues. Furthermore, Switzerland is very much in favor of constructive discussion with a view to a ministerial decision on the prevention of torture, this under the guidance of the German chair in office, to which my delegation would like to express its entire gratitude for the chair in office's commitment. Thank you very much. I thank the Swiss delegation for that statement. The next delegation to take the floor is now Norway, to be followed by Ukraine. Norway has the floor.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. HDIM has again provided us with insight into the experience, viewpoints, and challenges of our citizens through the civil society organizations represented here. My delegation is grateful to all civil society representatives for bringing these issues to our attention. Some have traveled far. Some tell us they have received threats of reprisal or even that family members have suffered negative consequences of their attendance. This is unacceptable. Human rights defenders have the right to communicate with and take part in international bodies. The main idea of HDIM is the exchange between civil society and governments. Intimidation of participants represents an attack on the OSCE itself. All participating states must refrain from reprisals and protect participants and their families from attacks by non-state actors. Participation at HDIM this year was higher than ever. We see this as a sign of the continued relevance of the meeting. We are concerned by the many testimonies of direct and indirect suppression of civil society organizations, restrictions on freedom of assembly and association, on freedom of expression and independent media, and abuse of the justice system for political purposes. These violations of OSCE commitments undermine enjoyment of human rights, democracy, and the rule of law. This threatens the stability of states and thereby security in our region. Mr. Chair, Norway considers improved implementation of existing commitments to be fundamental. However, our OSCE commitments should also be updated in line with developments in the UN and other international obligations. We look forward to proposals from the chairmanship that can be carried forward towards decisions in Hamburg. Some of the side events here have also provided input to our upcoming discussions. We thank the incoming Austrian chairmanship for giving us an overview of their priorities in the human dimension for the coming year. We look forward to working with them and other participating states in realizing these priorities. Mr. Chair, the crisis in and around Ukraine has once again featured prominently in our discussions. This is a consequence of the serious violations of fundamental commitments that have led to a breakdown of justice and grave human rights violations in eastern Ukraine and Crimea. We will continue to call on Russia to reverse its actions in Ukraine and renew its fundamental OSCE commitments in word and deed. Finally, we thank the host government, the German chairmanship, and not least ODIHR for having organized HDIM fully in line with the modalities of this meeting. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
I do thank very much, of course, the delegation of Norway for your words. The next delegation to take the floor will be Ukraine, followed by Austria, and then, of course, we have, for the time being, only one more delegation wanting to take the floor, that is Poland. So after that, we would then proceed to the right of reply, if so, of course, wished. So the floor is to the distinguished representative of Ukraine.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Distinguished participants, first of all, let me express sincere thanks to the ODIHR and the Polish host for excellent organization and hosting the 2016 Human Dimensions Implementation Meeting. Our discussions remain affected by the ongoing deepest crisis in the European security since the end of the Cold War. The crisis is a result of Russia's ongoing military aggression against Ukraine and the flagrant violation of the OSCE fundamental principles and commitments. It has resulted in illegal occupation of Ukraine's Crimea and bloody conflict in Donbas, where Russian weaponry and military personnel have killed thousands of Ukrainians, both civilians and military, for over 2 years. We wish to thank all delegations and civil society actors who demonstrate constant attention and genuine deep concern over the human rights situation in the Russia-occupied territories of Ukraine. Ukraine welcomes and supports the important role of the OSCE as part of international efforts aimed at assisting Ukraine in addressing the consequences of the Russian aggression. We highly value the role of the OSCE Special Monitoring Mission in contributing to diffusing tensions and fostering peace, stability, and security. Ukraine appreciates close cooperation with the OSCE autonomous institutions and the OSCE project coordinator in Ukraine. Dear colleagues, our 2-week discussion in this hall clearly reaffirmed that among many challenges that exist, the most glaring violations of human rights take place in the situations of occupation and authoritarian regimes, where the rule of terror and propaganda prevail, where the international organizations are not allowed to enter and establish a permanent monitoring. We once again emphasize that all responsibility for human rights violation in the temporary occupied territories of Ukraine rests with Russia in accordance with the international law. We strongly condemned the ban of Medlis by Russian occupant authorities in the Ukrainian Crimea, as well as ongoing repressions undertaken by Russia against Ukrainians and Crimean Tatars who oppose Russian occupation of Crimea. We, as our many international partners, do not recognize parliamentary elections held by Russia on the temporary occupied Crimea, which was yet another manifestations of Russia's violation of international law. We see the imperative to seek permanent monitoring and presence in Crimea of the UN, OSCE, and other international organizations in compliance with the UN General Assembly resolution on territorial integrity of Ukraine. The role of the OSCE institution is essential in this context, and we encourage the current and incoming OSCE chairmanships to provide every support to their efforts. We view an unacceptable that the issue of civil society participation in the HDIM was manipulated to advance the attempts to legitimize Russia's illegal occupation and annexation of Crimea. Distinguished participants, our debates have clearly indicated that the present Russia's external aggression cannot be considered in separation from Russia's non-compliance with the principles of democracy, rule of law, and human rights, which it committed to observe. We deplore the situation when the Russian authorities now, for years, avoid meaningful cooperation with the OSCE and other international institutions, placing obstacles and effectively burying their visits to Russia. We regret that the Russian Federation again failed to seize the opportunities offered by HDAM to commit to correcting the violations of fundamental OSCE principle and commitments. Dear colleagues, the current threats to human rights and security in the OSCE region emanating from the gross breach by one participating state of the Helsinki Decalogue principles and commitments must be duly reflected in the human dimension deliverables at the Hamburg Ministerial Council meeting. It is also essential that the incoming Austrian chairmanship places the issue of respect to the OSCE core principles and commitments as its key priority in office and focuses on seeking correction of violations and their full implementation. Our progress will depend upon the willingness and readiness of all participating states, without an exception, to abide by the OSCE principles and commitments fully and in good faith, as well as to take consistent efforts to uphold them. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much, Ambassador. Next delegation to take the floor is Austria, followed by Poland. Ambassador, the floor is yours.
Yeah, vielen Dank, Herr Vorsitzender.
Thank you, moderator. As leader of the Chairman's Task Force of Austria for 2017, I'm very pleased to have this opportunity to take the floor. In the light of our long-standing commitment to human rights, promoting this issue on behalf of the OSCE is a very important commitment for us, but also as the chairperson in office of this organization next year, the Minister Sebastian Kurz, during the Permanent Council in July 2016, talked about the various threats to security, but also about shared values in the OSCE space. Firstly, expansion of military conflict. Secondly, the growing threat in terms of domestic security, including the radicalization of young people. And thirdly, a lack of confidence between states. The respect for human rights commitments are a cross-cutting issue across these three points I spoke of. In a side event this week, we, for the first time, spoke of our priorities for the Austrian chairmanship in 2017 in cooperation with the ODIH. We talked about security, but also gender and women's empowerment. Under the title Promoting Diversity, we would also like to address the issue of freedom of the media. Moreover, we would like to improve the conditions of vulnerable groups, particularly people with disabilities and children. One particular aspect of our work should be freedom, confidence, and tolerance, non-discriminatory aspects. Interconfessional, interreligious dialogue is an important part of our life. And it will also thereby be at the core of our chairpersonship. And this is important to combat radicalization. The global concept of OSCE, as seen, of security as seen by OSCE, covers the human dimension. Therefore, the essence of the Paris Charter needs to remain in force, namely the respect for human rights as being the basis of a safe and stable Europe. On the event of the 25th anniversary of this event, the ODIHR once again demonstrated its comprehensive global expertise thanks to the participation of member states. To conclude, I would like to thank the ODIHR. I would also like to thank the German chairmanship for the excellent organization of this of this meeting, even though conditions were difficult. I'd also like to thank Poland for their warm hospitality here in Warsaw. Thank you very much.
Our team, thanks for your words. We're looking forward for very fruitful cooperation during our chairmanship. Next delegation to take the floor, and the last here on my list of speakers before we come to the right of reply, is the distinguished representative of Poland. The floor is yours.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. I would like to express our deep appreciation to ODIHR's director, Mr. Michael Gorg-Link, and his team for their excellent work on preparing the meeting. We are glad that during this HDIM, the discussions were in most cases substantive and focused on concrete human rights issues. Politicization, although not completely absent even during this segment, was perhaps less visible than last year. As we underline on many occasions, HDIM is of utmost importance to Poland, primarily because we are honored to be the host country of ODIHR, but also because we try to sustain the tradition of Warsaw as a center of dialogue on democracy and human rights. This year's edition of HDIM is exceptional due to the celebration of the 25th anniversary of the establishment of the OSCE Office for Democratic Institution and Human Rights here in Warsaw. And Poland is happy to be part of the celebration and the history of ODIHR. Let me commend the OSCE German chairmanship for their efforts to maintain human dimension at the heart of the OSCE agenda. We look forward to fruitful cooperation with Austrian chairmanship in 2017, and we would like to ensure our Austrian colleagues of our support. Mr. Chairman, current challenges in the field of human rights are numerous and growing by the day. We must face them in an adamant and efficient way. In order to do this, we need to achieve as much coordination as possible in the actions of the governments and civil society, but also we need to enhance the coherence between various international organizations active in the field of human rights. In this context, I would like to express satisfaction that a large number of OSCE participating states saw merit in our proposal to organize a meeting of directors for human rights issues in the capitals format. This meeting took place yesterday at the Ministry of Foreign Affairs of Poland and gathered participants from more than 35 OSCE states, an important contribution to our discussions on possible enhancement of cooperation between countries and international organizations in the field of human rights. We plan to host a similar meeting at next year's HDIM as well. We are grateful to all the participants from governments and civil society for having taken part in the past 2 weeks at HDIM, and we hope to see you in Warsaw next year. Finally, of course, Poland fully subscribes to the speech that was delivered earlier by the European Union. Thank you.
Thank you very much to the distinguished representative of Poland. Now we are at the end of the list of the delegations that wanted to take the floor in this closing session. We therefore move to the possibility of right of reply. Until now, one delegation has expressed the wish to do so. That is the delegation of the United States of America. Ambassador, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Chairman. I'll be brief. The Russian Federation made yet another effort to blame Ukraine for the Russian Federation's military intervention in that country. The absurdity of this claim is matched only by the Russian delegation's claim that somehow the Munich Agreement was responsible for World War II, and in effect that the Ribbentrop-Molotov Pact to militarily divide our host country and other member states was not. Facts are stubborn things. We urge the Russian Federation to face up to them. If its calls are for dialogue or to have any meaning, we need to start with the truth. Thank you.
Thank you very much to the distinguished representative of the United States. Another delegation wants to execute its right to reply. Azerbaijan, please, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. With regard to the statement of the delegate of Armenia, we urge Armenia to stop violating ceasefire and to stop resorting to armed provocations, conducting large-scale attacks against the civilian population of Azerbaijan residing in the close vicinity of the conflict zone, which results in civilian casualties. And with regards to the Ms. Ismailova's issues raised by the distinguished delegate of the United States, we have to stress that her imprisonment was substituted with release on probation by the decision of the competent court of Azerbaijan that reviewed her case. And according to the common legal practice, this is followed by certain conditions set forth by the court, including travel ban. Therefore, we're not going to comment on the decision of the court. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Are there any other delegations who want to exercise their right to reply? That's not the case. Therefore, let us. I'm sorry. Sorry, the distinguished representative of the Russian Federation, please.
Thank you, Chair. I'll be very brief in order to save time. I would just like briefly to respond to the last statement made in its right of reply by the United States of America. And I would like to remind our fellow delegate that what we base our views on in the Russian Federation is the truth and justice. And in this respect, we accept the appeal of the United States of America, yet let us indeed start with the truth. That is the best basis for cooperation and consultation.
Any other delegation wanting to take the floor here in the right of reply? This is not the case. So let us therefore move to the next point on our agenda, which is any other business. One delegation has asked here to take the floor. That is the delegation of the United States of America. Please, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. The United States has used this agenda item to follow up on the invocation of the Moscow mechanism. It is up to us, the participating states, to remain actively engaged on the concerns which gave rise to the invocation of the mechanism until they are resolved. And in this respect, we welcome Turkmenistan's participation in the meeting and hope that it reflects a desire to improve the country's human rights record. However, more than 13 years after the Moscow mechanism was invoked following hundreds of arrests, show trials, and allegations of torture connected to the alleged coup attempt of November 2002, we still lack adequate information on many individuals who disappeared into the prison system. As we heard during the meeting, there were almost 100 well-documented cases of such persons who have disappeared, including former OSCE Ambassador and Foreign Minister Batyr Berdiev and former Foreign Minister Boris Shikhmuradov. Many cases involve allegations of torture and abuse. The families of those who have disappeared have no information on the whereabouts or health of their loved ones or even whether they are dead or alive. There continue to be new cases, including the former RFERL correspondent Nepeskuliev, who was arrested last year on dubious drug charges after reportedly being given medicine while in detention. There's been no information on his whereabouts or condition, where the former cellmate has described the harsh conditions in which he was held. So we call upon the government of Turkmenistan to provide concrete information on these individuals as well as access to them. I'll switch gears briefly and update you on promised actions we have taken since the last HDIM. We engaged partners to ensure that the OSC response to the migrant and refugee challenge is consistent with human dimension commitments. We regularly publicize OSCE employment opportunities to a wide and diverse audience, and we convened expert meetings on constitutional policing, anti-discrimination initiatives, and a debate over capital punishment in the United States. We've listened carefully to criticisms and recommendations over the past 2 weeks. As is our custom, we are prepared to take some follow-up steps. These include building on a side event we hosted with civil society, we will organize a discussion on approaches to protecting the freedom of expression while countering hate speech online and offline. We will continue to update the Permanent Council and relevant OSCE institutions on constitutional policing and related anti-discrimination measures in the United States. In light of the migrant and refugee crisis, we will provide information on actions we are taking to assist and protect refugees. And finally, some participants still claim that their restrictive NGOs laws are similar to ours, and we, to debunk this false assertion, we will organize an event on our legal framework and explain how civil society functions freely in our country. Thank you, Mr. Moderator.
I do thank very much the distinguished representative of the United States for this information and for this welcome information on follow-up, of course, promised here, and I think that is certainly very positive to underline. Thank you for that. Any other delegations who want to take the floor under any other business? If this is not the case, let us now move to the three closing statements, which we will now, of course, share with you. And my pleasure is to give the floor for the first statement to the Secretary General of the OSCE, Mr. Lamberto Sanier, who is here today with us. Again, a warm welcome to you, Lamberto, and the floor is yours.
Thank you, dear Michael. Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, I would like to, first of all, congratulate you on 2 weeks of intense discussions. Many of you, not least our dear colleagues, may be relieved that we are about to draw the curtains on this meeting, but I'm sure you will all agree that HDIM is a truly unique event and always very worth attending. Having said this, once again, I regret not having been here for the opening. Finding a slot that does not coincide with high-level meetings of other international organizations may not be easy, but having HDIM coincide with a high-level segment of the UN General Assembly is really rather unfortunate. And in this connection, I would like to encourage you to relook at the dates, perhaps even by just simply moving it forward by 1 week. Having come back from New York, however, allows me to share a few thoughts about what I experienced there last week. From listening to the statements made in the General Assembly, from my meetings with ministers and other senior officials in the corridors and at various side events, I got a distinct impression, confirming what I heard at the humanitarian summit in Istanbul last May, that there is a growing sense among decision makers that we need to come together better as a world community to effectively manage the many challenges we're up against. Also in the OSCE, despite our divisions, the return of geopolitics, the urgency of addressing with priority many urgent and dramatic issues stemming from the crisis in and around Ukraine, we need to step up our efforts to find common ground and act jointly on issues ranging from terrorism and violent extremism to climate change, sustainable development, and migration. And in addressing all these challenges, we must make sure that the protection of human rights remains an integral part of our approach. In New York, I found increasing recognition for the crucial role that regional organizations such as the OSCE can play in contributing to global discussions and supporting local level implementation of global principles. This includes our continued effort to implement UNSCR 1325 on women, peace and security, as well as our increasing engagements in areas such as climate change, disaster risk reduction, or sustainable development. In my intervention at the UN Summit for Refugees and Migrants, I called for a comprehensive approach towards migration governance. Promoting tolerance and non-discrimination to strengthen inclusive societies must be a central part of our efforts. The summit's New York Declaration brings us closer to the aim of developing a more comprehensive and cooperative response to migration-related challenges. And OSCE expertise exists in many migration-related areas on issues such as human trafficking, migrant smuggling, cross-border criminal activities, border management, and police cooperation, but most critically also in relation to the protection of human rights of migrants and refugees and the promotion of tolerance and non-discrimination. Within the OSCE, we're making good progress in pulling all of this together into a more strategic and synergetic approach. I also attended a ministerial meeting on the group of friends of the UN Alliance Civilizations that was dedicated to combating xenophobia, where I stress the need to confront the growing populism and nationalist rhetoric that threatens to undermine peace and stability in many of our societies. Mr. Chairman, close coordination and cooperation inside the OSCE is also a significant precondition for building more effective relations with outside partners, including other international regional organizations, civil society, and the private sector, as well as an increasing number of other actors. Towns and cities are now playing a decisive role in responding to global security challenges. In a rapidly urbanizing world, they are frontline actors that are increasingly shaping the political, social, economic, and environmental conditions in their countries. As some of you know, in March next year, I'm planning to host, in cooperation with the mayor of Vienna, a security day on creating inclusive, safe, and sustainable cities, which is specifically aimed at engaging with mayors and city authorities. For this event, same as for many other projects, we will be seeking the input and support of ODIHR and other parts of the OSCE family. Ladies and gentlemen, in our increasingly interdependent world, we must work together to tackle the complex and interconnected security challenges we are facing. In this challenging environment, the promotion of human rights, democratic institutions, and the rule of law remain central to our mission to work towards peace and security. The OSCE participating states established IHDIM over 20 years ago to encourage a frank discussion with each other on the implementation of their human rights commitments. One of the IHDIM's great added values is that it allows for an open exchange of views on an array of issues that is accessible to all. ODIHR organizes IHDIM in full accordance with the modalities set by the OSCE participating states. But it is true that sometimes the issues you debate here are controversial, and sometimes IHDIM's openness can be misused for other aims. While we should continue to encourage the widest possible participation, our work should take place within the framework of a civilized conversation. In concluding, let's acknowledge the tremendous efforts made by Director Link and all his staff in organizing yet another fruitful meeting. And I would like to wish them all and all of you continued success for the future. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Secretary General Di Lamberto, now for your statement and for your words, also for the very good cooperation with you, with your team. And let me explicitly also extend it to the field missions which have been here partially also during this meeting, also especially this morning in the person of Vaidotas Verbas and his colleagues. Now let us move to the statement, the closing statement, on behalf of the German chairmanship of the OSCE. And it's my pleasure to give the floor to Ambassador Eberhard Pohl, with whose team also we are in a not only frequent and daily and successful exchange, but also, of course, having tried to prepare to the best of our possibilities together this HDIM. The floor is yours.
Thank you very much. As was said earlier, the special representative of the chairperson in office was not able to join us here today. And Dr. Erler has asked me to read out his statement on his behalf, and it will be in German. Lieber Michael Link, lieber
Dear Michael Link, Alberto Zanier, Your Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, I would like to greet all of you very cordially at this closing session of HDIM 2016. I know that HDIM requires a lot of effort and a lot of patience. Over these 2 weeks, we have had very significant debates, sometimes controversial, and we have been reminded on a daily basis of the commitments associated with the OSCE's human dimension. The overall human dimension of the OSCE was not created just to remain hot words, empty words. At a time when we are confronted with major security challenges. We must keep in mind that human rights and the human dimension are not an additional luxury or something that is negotiable. The implementation of the human dimension together with civil society is an obligation that weighs on all our shoulders because it really is the spinal column of security. Ladies and gentlemen, Minister Steinmeier at the opening of HDIM this year said that the human dimension is an integral part of security and stability within the Euro-Atlantic area. We must not forget that protection of human rights and fundamental freedoms is also and always a contribution to security and to stability. And we all agreed to this together in the Paris Charter and in subsequent documents accepted by consensus. Now, during the Cold War, at the time of the creation of ODIHR, that concept was already understood. Political instability and disorder is not a consequence of too much human rights, of too much democracy, but rather the consequence of an absence of the rule of law and an absence of prospects for human rights defenders. The crucial documents of 1990, on the basis of which the OECD implements human, OSCE implements human rights, have always stressed that democratic standards and human rights are an indispensable element of common security, of joint security. That contributes to stability and peace. Many subjects that we perceived as important in the past are still on the agenda here in Warsaw. The importance of democratic institutions and of free elections is obvious to all. Observing elections and democratic reform are really the hallmark of ODIHR's activity. And I welcome the fact that ODIHR has produced a guidebook for the implementation of recommendations in this regard. In 1999, participating states in Istanbul committed, and I quote, to ensure free and fair elections in line with OSCE commitments and to implement the recommendations of ODIHR. And now, sometimes these recommendations may not be much fun to implement, but they always contribute to a better electoral process and therefore a more credible result, more acceptable to all. And we must keep in mind this, the importance of strengthening the legitimacy of elections, and we must support the ODIHR in the accomplishment of its tasks and provide it with the required resources. Among the topical issues of the past that are still topical is freedom of association and expression. On the occasion of this year's HDIM, we produced a guideline on police behavior during demonstrations of civil society. And this guidebook should make it possible to strengthen the implementation of OSCE commitments when it comes to freedom of association through a few practical recommendations which are born of concrete experience and concrete observation. On the occasion of the G7 in June of 2015 in Melmau, we saw what difficulties there can be. We observed what was happening, and we took advantage of that to formulate recommendations. Now, what about rule of law and governance? I mean, these are really cornerstones of the human dimension since the Paris Charter, and since and they are crucial for stability. Ladies and gentlemen, the annual meetings of the implementation of the human dimension here in Warsaw should not only help to enshrine and to continue to strengthen our fundamental values of human rights and others. They are the best ways of reacting to political standards. Max van der Stel, the first minorities commissioner, called on this to be particularly stressed. At his first HDIM in 1993, he said that this is perhaps the best sensor for detecting all vibrations occurring in the sphere of human rights. It's also a platform for dialogue between civil society and participating states, making it possible to talk about crucial security and cooperation issues. More than 800 participants attracted to this HDIM shows that it has this dual function, an alert system, an early warning system, and a platform for dialogue, that can yield positive results. And there are also changes to freedom of information and opinion, which are crucial for a stable and active civil society. Especially at a time when there are certain campaigns of propaganda and misinformation using the most up-to-date means. Then there are all sorts of other subjects relating to refugees and migration. At these HDIM, we talked about combating trafficking in human beings. This criminal activity is a scourge for the poorest, the most vulnerable, especially women and children. That also finances criminal groups that are a threat to our collective security. We also stressed the need to reinforce tolerance and non-discrimination, how best to combat hate crimes, xenophobia, and intolerance. This discussion will continue at the pre-conference on diversity in Berlin. At the very heart of the debate, we had the protection of freedom of conscience, religion, belief, and thought. Now, the guaranteeing of these freedoms will really condition how we deal with other challenges, including those arising in states outside the OSCE area. So we must continue these efforts in common. Ladies and gentlemen, many different subjects were discussed here in Warsaw, and all of this, I think, underscored how important human rights are for stability and peace. So it was important that HDIM be able to meet here this year in Warsaw with a view to making it possible for us to seek a compromise and not to lose sight of this crucial OSCE building block that is the human dimension. I would like to thank civil society, the many human rights and fundamental freedoms defenders who came to Warsaw, who protect human rights and fundamental freedoms in their countries, and who come so that we can hear them out. As member states, I think that this should incite us to certain actions and should also make us understand that everything that we do to defend the freedom of the individual is crucial. This exchange between participating states and civil society is really the brand name of these HDIM meetings. To ensure that this continues, we must respect freedom of speech at the HDIM. We must ensure full integrity, physical as well, of all participants before, during, and after the meetings. We should be open to any constructive proposal that could improve the effectiveness and the visibility of these meetings. And over the weeks and months to come, we would call on all participating states to participate in an active discussion on that subject. Ladies and gentlemen, this HDIM also is an opportunity to discuss certain issues forcefully and without taboo. Anything within the human dimension is on the agenda. The OSCE as a whole is an open platform, as is the HDEM, and I'm very pleased, of course, that this is also an opportunity to exchange our divergences. Now, in this anniversary year, 25th anniversary year of ODIHR, we should keep in mind what the situation was when ODIHR was born. It was a time of tension, of threats to stability and to peace. There was a lot of democratization upheaval in Europe. So we need to continue to discuss this in the months to come. And the ministerial meeting in Hamburg will be an opportunity for us to reiterate how important our commitments in this regard are. I would certainly count on all of you to participate at the highest possible level. I think that we can measure the value of our discussions by trying to measure to what extent we have managed to strengthen the human dimension. So I would appeal to all of you to make that particular effort. And I wish you all a bon voyage and a safe return home.
Representative of the German Chamber of State, Gernot Erler, who unfortunately, as you said, cannot be with us personally today. Let me move on, therefore, to my own closing remarks on behalf of ODIHR before we indeed adjourn our meeting. It is with pleasure that, of course, that we have, and it was mentioned sometimes, we have learned then late in the year that the green light was coming to finally organize this meeting. And I think you all know that it is sometimes indeed not easy to organize such a meeting very short notice. And we don't say that simply out of us, because, but there are, let me remind all of us, there are existing modalities, say, even with timeframes, when we should be ready by organizing with such a meeting. I hope very much that in the future we can come to a situation where we can more timely prepare, thus also more timely take up proposals from you, certainly in preparing this very important event. I will now refrain from giving a long and detailed report about individual working sessions. Instead, I will provide the delegations with written reports and present them on our website in due course. Furthermore, as per established practice, I'm going to present my full report about this year's Human Dimension Implementation Meeting to the participating states in front of the Permanent Council in Vienna on October 13th, already very soon. Ladies and gentlemen, as you all know, this was the 20th Human Dimension Implementation Meeting here in Warsaw, held in the year of the 25th anniversary of the existence of our office. Moreover, I'm happy to report that the third Human Dimension Implementation Meeting of my tenure as the director of ODIHR has been the third HDIM now in a row to break records of attendance. We have had an impressive number, we have heard it already, of almost 1,800 registered representatives from governments, NGOs, civil society, 55 participating states, and among these, we have been able to welcome 803 representatives of civil society. Furthermore, there was another record number of 92 side events. This record becomes more apparent as we are slowly reaching the limits of the physical capacity of this venue to accommodate such a larger number of participants. One way of dealing with this was the launch event of our new, quote, turning words into action to address anti-Semitism, end of quote, project on Wednesday evening, which we organized in the wonderful Polin Museum of the History of Polish Jews as a breakout session of sorts. I warmly encourage you, delegations and civil society alike, to use this also as an example of how we can together break out from the routine of always having side events in the same venues, and thereby making HDIM an even more interactive and diverse event. And that is indeed what we try to make it more interactive and more diverse. I also do hope that you enjoyed the panel discussion during the opening session, which was also a further step to making the exchanges of ideas at HDIM even more vivid and to inspire an even more open debate during the numerous sessions we have and we had in the course of these weeks. Or, let me underline again, the live streaming we do since some years the wall where we pictured the commitments and Twitter. And of course, not to forget also the app, the application which we have this year for the first time to ease for all of you following the agenda or possible changes in the agenda. But also, let me be very clear, quantity of participants, I speak of record numbers, isn't everything. No, it is not anything worth in itself. It is the quality of the contribution that counts. As every year, we have heard an impressively wide range of recommendations to participating states in the area of the human dimension, many of which pointed out significant gaps in the implementation of their commitments. And we have seen impressive personalities taking the floor. Let me only mention one. Most of you, I think all of you who had the opportunity to attend in person the meeting yesterday with Pauline Dorich from Stuttgart, the young girl with her work on migrants, that was really something absolutely outstanding and impressive. In fact, I cannot help but notice that we unfortunately, of course, also see negative trends. I was speaking in my opening session or my opening speech in the working session number one, for example, about this so-called, well, what I call the implementation gap very often between what is in the commitments and is implemented in laws, and the implementation gap between what's in laws and what is in real life. Yes, there is certainly this implementation gap. We have to deal with that. And as this implementation gap is getting larger, the space for civil society very often in many places is shrinking. There are numerous examples from the entire OSCE region for the difficulties civil society activists face in their work, east and west of Vienna. But we don't have to look too far to see how some governments react towards these activities when they dare to speak out and criticize their shortcomings in the human dimension. Let me repeat what I said in the opening, in my opening session, in the opening words in the working session number one. No participating state has ever become less stable by implementing OSCE commitments. Quite the other way around. No one likes to be criticized, and no one likes to be reminded of his or her very own shortcomings. I understand that this is by no means a pleasant exercise, but HDIM was never supposed to be a pleasant. It is and always has been a place for open dialogue and discussion, a place where even controversial standpoints could be debated and exchanged in a peaceful and civilized manner. It is thus completely unacceptable, let me underline that, completely unacceptable that we have in the last 2 weeks witnessed and heard credible reports about attempts to intimidate and silence representatives of NGOs and civil society as a retaliation for the statements they made in the course of this meeting. Any action, whether before, during or after HDIM, directed at stifling the open and constructive debate here in Warsaw, needs to be met with unequivocal condemnation by all participants and all delegations from all participating states. We are, after all, talking about commitments that every one of our participating states has agreed to, whether in Moscow, in Istanbul, in Maastricht, or in Astana. We have all agreed that civil society needs to play a vital role in the promotion of human rights, democracy, and the rule of law. HDIM is a unique platform to reflect on these historic achievements and landmark documents, and it is one of the very few places in the world where representatives from civil society can discuss with representatives from governments on an equal footing. This is an incredibly valuable forum, and we should all appreciate and cherish it. Of course, all form of criticism and protest have to be done also in a way that allow us to orderly conduct the meeting. That is absolutely true equally. The clear goal and commitment of ODIHR is to preserve HDIM as this place of open debate and to keep it as open and as accessible as possible so that every voice can be heard. I do hope that we at ODIHR will be able to continuously count on your support in this matter. Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, let me conclude by warmly thanking all of you who were attending. You brought this event to life. But of course, let me also explicitly thank, of course, and I want to begin here with our host country, Poland, for the long organizational work we had to do together. Certainly, of course, to the OSCE chairmanship. All representatives, by the way, also of Troika. Serbia is now leaving the Troika. Thanks again for that excellent cooperation. We are looking forward, as I said already, to the next year, working together closely with Austria. We are thanking very much, of course, all our colleagues from the OSCE institutions. Dunja Mijatović was here in person, the colleagues from HCNM, Lamberto Zanier, the colleagues from the field offices, of course. All these colleagues I want to thank a lot, including, not to forget, also the OSCE Parliamentary Assembly, who is today in parallel as we sit here meeting in Skopje. And, of course, it is absolutely important to thank all of those of you who are international organizations and civil society. You have partially taken a very, very long way to come here to discuss with us. We thank you very much for your valuable contribution. The civil society presence here is what makes this event unique. I also would like to thank, of course, all our introducers, moderators, rapporteurs, everybody who brought, of course, elements and life here in this session. And I thank, of course, also our interpreters who helped us to understand each other. And, of course, the last thank, not the least one, a very large one, goes to the ABLE team and to the very, very dedicated team at ODIHR, who over the weekends thank you. Thank you. Who many weekends, many hours, of course, were working to make this a success together, and who will be glad to host you in the future for events to come and to organize them together with you and to have them together with you. I hope that we will see each other, many of us already, Eva announced it, at the 19th and 20th of October at the huge and important chairmanship conference on tolerance and diversity. I think that's a good, very good thing to take up a lot of things which we have discussed here. And now let me also personally thank of you and to wish all of you a safe trip, a safe travel home, back to your families, back to your homes. Thank you all for attending this year's Human Dimension Implementation Meeting, and the meeting is closed.